Of the many UFO-related events that continue to plague planet Earth, none is more perplexing to experts than the escalating reports of USOs, unidentified submerged objects.
USO sightings continue all around the world to this very day. They continue to come out of the water, and they continue to be seen by witnesses around the world.
Since our last USO report, extraordinary new facts, stories, and details have come to light about this most elusive class of UFO.
It was the summer 2000. My ship was visiting Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, when I saw three strange big white lights in the water.
Witness for the first time new evidence of USO-related anomalies on the surface of our oceans and waters.
USOs can manifest crop circles on water.
And find out why one of America's first nuclear-armed aircraft carriers, the USS Franklin Delano Roosevelt, continued to be a magnet for reported UFO and USO events for over 30 years.
I was on the USS Franklin D. Roosevelt in 1958, and I seen a UFO when we were out at sea.
From brand new reports of deep sea UFOs, the stories that go back over 100 years, many experts continue to wonder, are we the first inhabitants of our planet, or are they? In early 2006, after viewing the History Channel's broadcast of deep sea UFOs, 36-year-old U.S. Navy Chief Petty Officer Charles Howard was just one person to contact the network with stories and accounts of unusual, frightening, and terrifying unidentified objects in our waters. Petty Officer Howard, a 17-year veteran of the Navy, tells his story of a possible USO encounter for the first time.
The History Channel was broadcasting a show about UFOs and USOs. I never heard of USOs. I thought that was very interesting because I had an experience. I never shared it with anybody, but I thought it was pretty interesting.
In the summer of 2000, Howard's ship, the USS Thorne, was docked off Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, after routine maneuvers.
It was kind of late, 10 o'clock, so I was coming back to the ship. I'm walking down the pier. I was pretty tired, so I wanted to get back before everybody, you know, so I get back and get some sleep. And the pier was pretty long. I was about 30 paces ahead of everybody. I saw like this glowing white light out of the corner of my eye. I was walking, I kind of looked to the side, and it was glowing under the water.
The glowing USO initially appears about 30 yards from the pier. Howard estimates the object at almost 10 feet across. As it approaches, Howard comments he couldn't tell if the object was man-made.
At first it kind of like popped up out of nowhere, like a soft white glow. As I'm looking at it, it gets brighter and brighter, and then that's when the other two lights popped up behind it. Almost formed like a triangle. It was a light here, and a light here. At first I really wasn't afraid because it was just one soft light. It just was kind of weird to me. But then when the other two lights popped up behind it and they started moving, that's when I got kind of afraid. I was like, hey guys, come look at this, look at this.
The other seamen respond to Howard's calls, but arrive too late. The USO has disappeared under the water. He has never seen anything like it before or since, and hopes to never see another.
I've been out to sea for almost 17 years now. I've never seen anything like this. It was weird.
Similar sightings continue to surface from the areas adjacent to Santa Catalina Channel off the coast of Los Angeles.
Tomorrow, off a dive ship, we're going to go out with divers to find trace evidence of that 1992 USO sighting right here in Santa Monica Bay.
June 14th, 1992, 10:24 p.m. Multiple witnesses reported seeing over 200 bright, disc-shaped objects silently exiting the water and hovering for a moment before bursting into space. Reports of this incident were phoned into local police departments as far away as Malibu.
Officer of Sheriff's Station, did anyone report anything strange tonight?
Be a little more specific. Strange
light.
Light? Yes. what exactly happened to you?
I'm ashamed to tell you because I think you're going to think you're crazy. We saw what we thought was a bright light up in the sky.
Okay.
We could hear it wasn't a helicopter. I'm telling you, I have never been more frightened in my life.
On March 9th, 2006, Patrick Uskert, Kevin Bruhn, and Julius Willis invited the History Channel along on a research expedition to seek evidence of USOs in the Santa Catalina Channel. Where, coincidentally, at 9:37 p.m. the night before, witnesses reported seeing several disc-shaped silver USOs diving into and out of the channel. Uskert, Bruhn, and Willis were joined on this 11-hour quest by UFO researcher and veteran sailor Captain William Burns, and by Preston Dennett, who first reported on this large-scale 1992 USO event in these waters off of Los Angeles in our previous broadcast.
So we're all set today, right? You got the Geiger counter?
I got all the scientific equipment.
You have
ready
all
to
the
go.
Vials and everything we need.
Yep.
You got the tanks.
I got the tanks.
You got
I got
underwater
the camera.
Yeah.
Infrared.
Housing.
Infrared we have.
Yeah. We're all set.
Great.
Okay, let's go.
Their plan is to dive in two areas of the channel. Divers Uskert and Bruhn will collect samples, and Bruhn, a PhD and research scientist, will conduct preliminary testing on the ship and further testing later in his lab.
Our mission was to go down, collect samples, and basically look for any evidence of underwater UFOs.
In this largely unexplored area, called the Redondo Trench, detection of USOs has been hampered by its incredible depth, in some places reaching almost 1 mile. Sonar on most ships is incapable of tracking anything this deep.
Good morning, folks. Welcome aboard Pacific Star.
Morning.
I guess we're going to go out to the trench this morning. Trench drops off fast, probably a 60-degree angle. Drops down to, my meter goes to 1,400 feet, and I can't find the bottom. We don't want to go too deep because we don't know what's there.
Joe!
The ship leaves Redondo Beach, California at 8:37 a.m. It heads due west into the murky waters of the Pacific. The team faces a strong breeze and heavier than normal chop.
The only thing that could possibly be worse is if that wind were to pick up. Well, as we get these ground swells rolling through like this, they will stir up the bottom 70, 80 foot down. Have to bump into them down there in order to find anything.
At 9:22 a.m., the team catches their first glimpse of something unusual.
Look at that! Holy cow!
A strange anomaly is witnessed on the surface of the water.
Guys, I'm serious. Look at that!
The round impression, approximately 15 feet across, vibrates constantly as it is seen to disappear as quickly as it came.
Sounds crazy, but there have been a lot of UFO crashes, 40 or 50 at least. So it's entirely possible that there is some type of material down there. There's plenty of places for USOs to hide.
That's the trench.
The captain orders the anchor down about 2 nautical miles downrange.
We're looking for a couple of things. Are there any patterns on the bottom of the water, any trace evidence that remains from the soil? Is there any radioactivity down there? Are there any strange elements?
People in this area saw this craft last night. So if that craft was here last night, if that craft left the traces, our guides on the bottom are collecting those traces now and bringing them up to the surface, and we're going to see these traces be tested.
What's the visibility like down
there?
Like
5 to 10 feet.
Yeah, 5 to 10 feet.
Too rough to see anything. Couldn't see much when we were down. Hopefully Pat's getting some footage, maybe some samples.
While Uskert reported that he sensed something peculiar in the water, the conditions prevented him from seeing it. He did, however, collect samples for testing.
Couldn't see a thing, just my flashlight beam going into blackness.
if there is someone who wanted a place to hide, that'd be a pretty nice place to hide. Nice and dark, nice and deep.
I didn't feel like I belonged there. I didn't feel like I was supposed to be there.
Due to poor visibility at this location, the team moves 4 miles downrange, even further into the channel.
We're going to head out to another spot where, again, if you were trying to camouflage yourself, you're probably sitting right here in the best place to be camouflaged.
With underwater visibility of less than 15 feet at the first location, the divers prep a more sensitive camera to record evidence in this deeper area.
Here's your camera. I already got it in the housing.
You okay?
I'll set it up so it's especially sensitive to low light. If anything down there, you're going to see it.
Samples from the bottom of the ocean bed, and they're going to be testing these for radioactive traces and chemical traces. USOs leave traces. Maybe they're magnetic, maybe they're highly electrical charged. They're looking to test for electrical charges, for magnetism, and for radioactivity.
The clearer conditions at this location help the divers collect samples. And this time, they find something unusual.
I'm pretty satisfied with what we collected.
We're gonna check it with the Geiger counter, see if they're reading hot.
Great.
So just open the lid on these. Negative. This one.
Whoa. You got a lot of small samples here. Wow.
Okay. All right. We got something.
Due to the elevated Geiger counter reading, the team decides further testing is needed.
All right, the rest we can do back at the lab.
Awesome.
So it's really no mystery why a USO would choose this particular area to hide in. They just can't be seen.
We can't really know what the results will be until we analyze everything and put it all together. But it's all part of the process.
What we try to do is test our hypotheses by setting up very controlled experiments, trying to eliminate variables. And out here, it's very difficult to eliminate all these variables that we deal with. So we're kind of on the level of just observing. And if anything comes up strange or worthy of continuing investigation, then we'll certainly be back out here, I think.
Kevin will probably agree with me here, right? There's a good probability that they're down there.
If you're going to find anything, you got to look.
Further testing on the USO sample proved inconclusive. However, due to the initial positive result on sample number 2, a more comprehensive USO dive is planned for the fall of 2006.
We got to go back.
Coming up, we'll open the secret files of one of America's first nuclear-armed aircraft carriers, the USS Franklin D. Roosevelt, to uncover why she continues to be at the heart of the worldwide USO controversy. Of the U.S. Navy's many great technical achievements after World War II, few surpass the dramatic might, power, and capabilities of its Midway-class carrier, the USS Franklin D. Roosevelt. Commissioned on October 27, 1945, from the New York Naval Shipyards, the 1,000-foot-long, 64,000-ton FDR was one of the first ships in the Navy's fleet to carry nuclear weapons full-time.
The Franklin D. Roosevelt was a very capable ship in every stretch of the imagination. She was an experimental floating active laboratory for the entire Navy Department.
According to many of the men who served aboard the FDR, the ship's sophisticated capabilities caused the carrier to be at the center of one of the great USO mysteries of the 20th century.
I have no doubt about their existence of UFOs and their interaction with the Franklin D. Roosevelt, and there have been many other sailors out there who have had the same experience as I have had.
There's probably a good connection with the USS FDR and the nuclear weapons and the UFO sightings, the magnet for UFOs.
Chet Grusinski served aboard the FDR from July 1958 until December 1960 as a fireman and metalworks engineer. He says his harrowing close-range encounter with a large USO-like object in September 1958 off Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, has distressed him ever since. He tells his story on camera for the first time.
We're down below decks this evening between 8 and 9 o'clock. It was dark outside. A bunch of men come running up the ladder from the engine. My buddy then said, hey, Red, why don't you go up there and see what's going on? So I followed those men all the way up the ladder, up to the hangar deck, all the way up to the flight deck.
Grusinski witnessed a cigar-shaped UFO traveling at an incredible speed toward the FDR. He also comments that the object made no sound and maneuvered unlike any man-made aircraft.
We had no air operations going on. The flight deck was quiet up there. And this thing just came right at us, and I could see what the light was when it came at our ship. It was a row of windows with figures inside. And they got close enough, I could feel the heat on my face and those figures looking at us through those windows. And the impression I got that those figures were looking at us were not human beings. And then this thing turned like a bright red-orange color, and I could see the shape of it. It was a cigar shape when it turned colors, and then it just took right off like that.
Grusinski further reports that this bright USO-like craft rose from the water and remained relatively silent over this 45-second event before flying away. Approximately 25 of his shipmates reportedly witnessed this event as well. Most, he says, were quickly transferred off the FDR. Even more curious, he alleges that within hours, the ship's logbook was altered.
When I got the deck log, a lot of things are blackened out on the logbooks. There's nothing in there. And the witness was crashing off the ship, and they probably, I imagine they must have had to sign some papers to say something about it, or what, but I never had to sign anything like that, maybe because I didn't see that much about it. You know?
After almost 50 years, his search for answers about what really happened that night continues.
I'm still trying to find these men on the flight deck. I didn't have to sign the papers. I wasn't transferred off the ship. I got a lot of whys. What happened? Why? That's what it is. That's why I've been spending all these years of research on it.
But Grusinski is not alone in his belief that he witnessed a UFO while serving aboard the FDR. A second FDR veteran, Harry Jordan, served aboard the FDR from 1962 until 1965 as Seaman First Class. His rating as a radar operator put him in charge of one of the world's most advanced and sensitive radar systems.
She also had the capability of jamming rockets, you know, continental ballistic missiles, and even break through some of the countermeasures being put upon us by Soviet bloc countries.
While on duty in 1963, Jordan says he became part of another significant USO event aboard the ship that has remained secret until now.
And the Roosevelt definitely attracted UFOs because of all of the technical equipment and all of the armaments that she had, and also nuclear weapons.
Jordan agreed to tell his mysterious and alarming story of possible USO contact for the first time.
I do remember the incident and the details of it because it just stays with you when you've gone through this.
October 2nd, 1963, off the coast of Sardinia, approximately 2 a.m. Jordan stands watch over his radar monitor. All is normal on this unusually warm fall night. Suddenly and without warning, he says, a contact abruptly appears on his screen, an object 600 miles downrange at an altitude almost impossible for conventional aircraft to reach at the time, 80,000 feet.
First blip came on at the beginning of about 2.5 hours into the watch. It was 600 miles from the ship at 80,000 feet. Then it came into 300 miles at about 35,000 feet. And then it came into about 10 miles at 10, 15,000 feet from the ship off our port side. I reported it to the watch commander at the time, and he came over, went through the same process and confirmed it and reported it to the officer of the deck on the bridge. Then the officer of the deck on the bridge woke up the captain after this contact started to move.
An object on Jordan's screen begins moving at a speed and on a course that, he believes, would have crushed any man-made aircraft.
This thing was covering 10 miles in just a few seconds, and it was traveling about 4,000 miles an hour. It was making right-angled turns, and it was almost like a Z pattern if you took about four Zs and lined it across your scope. So I could tell that she was going pretty fast, and then so when she stops, they didn't have any heat signature. Okay? This was highly unusual.
After Jordan makes his report, he says the FDR's captain orders the launch of a pair of Phantom II jets to analyze the situation.
They went to afterburners and then launched one right after the other. They left the Rosie and headed up on a course of about 012. So then I thought immediately that there might be something new going on here because that wasn't following protocol as far as normal ship operations that I was used to.
The Phantom jets, now about 20 miles downrange, still seek contact with the object. Jordan reports that the blip on his radar screen continues to dive close to the USS FDR before it disappears in a literal flash.
It's being recorded on the view board up on the right-hand side in CIC, and then the contact winked out about 20, 30 seconds after the... And I could hear one of the pilots say, "What the?" That's all I heard.
Moments later, he says, as quickly as it disappeared, the target returns, but now it's bigger and closer.
The Phantom II has landed, and then it winked back on again off the port side of the ship, and something went yelled out in CIC, you know, "What the hell is that?" And I bet you had 15 people out there with binoculars looking.
2:32 a.m. In full view of the FDR's crew, the USO reportedly hovers for a moment, several hundred feet from the ship, before disappearing.
I saw the Z pattern and it stopped, it winked out, and then it was gone. I know what the fingerprints are of the electronics on Soviet aircraft, Korean aircraft, Chinese, MiGs, you name it. If it had been a meteor, it would have burned up in the atmosphere, and I have seen meteors streak across the scope, but it only happens in about 2 or 3 seconds. I mean, it's gone.
2:36 a.m. Jordan records the event in his logbook as a UFO incident. Seconds later, he says his commanding officer bursts in.
"Jordan, what did you put in your log?" And I had UFO in there, and I had the contact number at the time. I held it up in front of the commander, and he says, "You can take that out." My commander acknowledged to me in not so many terms that, "Yeah, Jordan, that's what it was, but no, Jordan, nobody else is to know. Period." I had too much respect for him and the Navy to say anything about it for over 20 years. This was an historical moment for the United States Navy, and it was left out of the logs.
As astonishing as these mysterious first-hand encounters aboard the FDR might be, they are far from the only ones. During her unusually brief 32-year commission, the FDR will host at least a half dozen similar events.
The FDR seemed to have been attractive to USOs. She certainly saw a lot of them.
Coming up, the 1952 NATO mission Operation Mainbrace is rocked by continuous UFO and USO reports. The lead ship, the USS FDR.
Wallace Litwin took photos of the flying disc going over the USS FDR in Operation Main Brace.
And I've interviewed three people separately who have been on the FDR where large UFOs have been seen over the ship, observing it, making its presence known, and at times interfering with what appears to be some of the electronics on the ship.
The Franklin Delano Roosevelt was the first aircraft carrier to carry nuclear weapons, and UFOs seem to be drawn to anything that's nuclear related. The first instance of this occurring was in the North Sea off England on NATO operations.
September 1952, NATO initiates Operation Mainbrace, the first cooperative multilateral maneuvers since the war.
The FDR was part of a NATO fleet exercise off Denmark called Operation Mainbrace. The FDR and the RAF and British aircraft carriers were witnesses to one of the most incredible multiple USO sightings in history.
The Ministry of Defense in the UK actually wrote it up as a USO sighting.
The exercise involves 200 ships, 1,000 planes, and over 80,000 men from its member nations in the waters near Denmark. As one of the largest and most advanced ships of the time, the USS FDR leads the way.
She was part of a task force that was sealing off the Russian submarine access through the North Sea into the Atlantic. Extremely important, because what if there had been a USO base underneath the North Sea in that area north of Europe? We were surveilling them, they were surveilling us.
September 13, 1952. The Danish destroyer Willemoes is in the Baltic Sea north of Bornholm Island. Lieutenant Commander Schmidt Jensen and several crew members reportedly see a luminous triangular shaped object moving at high speeds above the water in close proximity to the main fleet. The bluish object travels westward and suddenly turns southeast directly toward the FDR. Over the next week, there are several more sightings stretching from Denmark back to the Air Operations Command bases in Scotland. September 20th, 1952, 7:30 p.m. Three Danish officers reportedly observe a shiny disc-shaped object rise from the water and pass over them, again headed toward the NATO fleet and the FDR. The fast-moving metallic UFO heads east and disappears into the cloud layer. September 21st, 1952, less than 24 hours later, six British pilots above the North Sea spot a shiny spherical object rising from the water and stealthily approach the fleet's location. They reportedly give chase, but the swift-moving object evades their pursuit. FDR veteran Jordan says that he spoke to a witness over 40 years ago.
They had a sonar contact from three or four destroyers, and they couldn't figure out what the hell it was because it was moving with them, and the damn thing was like a quarter mile wide, and it came up out of the water, and when it did, it dinged one of the ships, and that was later reported as a collision between two destroyers. And he says that's not what happened, because he went up and he said this damn thing came up out of the water and flew up.
According to reports, all of these sightings share a similar eerie trait. The witnesses uniformly feel that these USO objects, whatever they might be, are actually observing the naval exercises at close range.
After Operation Mainbrace, there were so many sailors who saw the objects and airmen from the RAF that saw the objects. This wasn't just one or two people. These were crew members on the USS FDR. So this is one of those very famous multiple sightings where everybody saw these objects.
One journalist aboard the USS FDR during the operations had perhaps the very best view of this reported swarm of USO activity through his camera lens. September 20th, 1952, 11 a.m. Several crewmen witness yet another fast maneuvering spherical USO rise from the water to the sky just behind the fleet. Journalist Wallace Litwin, on board the FDR documenting the operation, points his 35mm Canon camera at the horizon and quickly snaps two images of a fast-moving disc that seemingly defies all laws of gravity. The images were believed to have been studied by the Navy, but no official report was ever filed.
Wallace Litwin took photos of the flying disc going over the USS FDR in Operation Mainbrace. I got copies of his photographs there. It shows the object going over the ship, and you see the ship's superstructure and part of a wing of an airplane. Just like a bright light going over a ship with the forward show, but they said it was like a disc light to some of the witnesses.
USO sightings aboard the USS FDR during Operation Mainbrace were not exclusive to enlisted men and non-coms. Some believe that General Dwight Eisenhower may have even witnessed similar objects as a guest aboard the FDR.
I have heard reports that Eisenhower was on the FDR when one of these sightings occurred. The people who are these serious witnesses to operations and events have been afraid to come forward, both because they've been threatened, they're also afraid of being ridiculed.
According to experts, many documents involving Mainbrace remain classified. However, others have been released. Is there a motive for officials to keep 50-year-old events secret?
The military, in fact, the militaries of all First World nations treat these things as threats. They say the fact that they can penetrate airspace, they can go into highly secure areas, they can outfly our fastest jets. Does that mean they're hostile?
Although many FDR veterans and researchers suspect that the ship's advanced capabilities may have made her a target for otherworldly attention, some wonder, could all of this reported activity actually serve as proof?
I have spoken with people over the years, since my Roosevelt experience and that one, and have seen the evidence firsthand. To those who have not had those experiences, you cannot know what you've yet to experience, and hopefully you'll believe that they are out there.
Coming up, the architect of modern USO research, Ivan T. Sanderson's controversial discoveries and extraordinary USO cases. And later from Australia, two disc-like objects are witnessed leaving an impression on the surface of the water.
Now, Ivan Sanderson, explorer, taking you into adventure.
USOs in general are unidentified submerged objects. USOs have been in history for a long, long time, and an associate and friend of mine, Ivan T. Sanderson, did a study of them long ago. They are there all the time. They're in the data. They're a part of the phenomena.
Even more frightening than extraterrestrials is what Ivan T. Sanderson said when he wrote the book Invisible Residents. They're not extraterrestrials. They're already here.
To this day, the pioneering USO research by zoologist and former British spy Ivan T. Sanderson continues to astound and frighten experts and buffs alike. His controversial 1970 book, Invisible Residents, forever opened the world's eyes and ears to the murky realm of unidentified submerged objects. Sanderson proposes two primary theories about USOs and invisible residents. The first is that USOs are in fact here and have either evolved along with the Earth or have come from space and made a home in our oceans long ago.
When you talk about underwater UFOs, you have to remember that 3/4 of the Earth's surface is covered with water. And UFOs are seen pretty much all over the Earth in every country. So it's not at all surprising that they're using the oceans, because we haven't even fully explored the oceans ourselves.
Sanderson's USO theories lead to a stark prospect. If over 50% of UFO reports occur on or above water, as he reports, are over 50% of these UFOs in fact USOs?
You know, UFOs are not just being seen over land. Ivan T. Sanderson said that 50% of all UFOs were actually being seen over bodies of water.
Do USOs mean that living underneath the surface of planet Earth is a whole civilization of creatures, entities, aliens, for whom Earth is home, just as it's home for us on the surface? And these were residents who've been here for millions of years, probably before life evolved on the surface of the planet.
As evidence of his second theory, Sanderson says there are several crucial points across the Earth, together forming an unseen invisible map, triangles that he refers to as vile vortices. By locating the areas where ships and aircraft reportedly disappear, Sanderson realized that the USO sightings correlate almost perfectly with the triangles on Earth, where it is believed that strange magnetic anomalies occur.
He wondered if some of these unusual spaces, whether they were called triangles or, you know, vortices or whatever, might have unusual animals, might have USOs coming in and out of them.
Sanderson's vortices theory has a terrible dark side as well. The major areas of anomaly are the areas located in some of the most treacherous water regions on Earth.
Ivan Sanderson did a latitudinal study and found out that there is a line around the planet in which geographic north and magnetic north merge. And these are areas that have a great deal of lost vessels, lost planes, and manifestations of objects.
After 17 years of research, Sanderson came to one startling conclusion. There is a clear link between the high number of USO reports and the areas of unusual gravitational or vortic poles on Earth. The specific areas where the two intersect are the mysterious triangle regions off Bermuda, Japan, and Australia.
I think it's about time that somebody does go into this thing, instead of just sitting sadly and saying it doesn't exist, or saying it's a forgery, go ahead and prove it.
According to Sanderson, this link is no coincidence. He believes that the unusual magnetic hotspots on Earth and high number of USO sightings are connected, and for a reason. In fact, some USO researchers have interpreted the vortices as likely locations of USO bases.
Where he began to think about underwater bases, are they aliens from outer space? Are they really interacting with us?
And I believe that over time, there have, at various times, there have been concentrated areas of extraterrestrial facilities that are based underwater, very deep and undetectable, where they've been observing what we're doing.
USOs might be indigenous to planet Earth. They were even here before we were.
A remarkable yet virtually forgotten USO case from Sanderson's research is the mysterious St. Andrew incident off the coast of Nova Scotia, Canada, on October 30th, 1906.
One of the great cases from the early part of the 20th century is the SS St. Andrew. She was a vessel that was crossing the Atlantic on her way to Hamburg. She was off Halifax when not only her crew, but passengers aboard that ship sighted a UFO.
Sanderson reports that at 4:30 p.m., the ship was bombarded by a huge flaming object that zigzags through the sky, falls into the water, and disappears. But according to his reports, it couldn't have been a meteor, because meteors do not zigzag and move with apparent intelligent control. The story was even covered in the New York Times. First Officer V.E. Spencer says, quote, "I have seen meteors all over the world, but never such a large one as this." Throughout Sanderson's career, a cloud of mystery drifted around him.
Sanderson was a part of the British Intelligence Service, but what we're really cloudy about is a lot of his friends were in the OSS, which was the precursor to the CIA, and then, as we can tell from some of his books, Sanderson had a direct connection to the Office of Navy Intelligence and was getting information from them.
Until his death in 1973, Sanderson traversed the globe in search of underwater submerged objects. Today, some USO experts believe his research was provided to him by highly placed government sources.
Many of us wonder, was Sanderson still in the intelligence services? Was he still going on some of his expeditions, some of his explorations, and using part of what he was doing to feed back to his old friends in intelligence services, but also getting new information for his books from them too?
At the end of his life, weakened by cancer, Sanderson fell victim to friends and enemies alike who coveted his research.
A lot of people would back their station wagon up to his bunkhouse and said they were going to borrow files and never brought them back.
Speculation continues in various circles about whether secret government operatives removed Sanderson's files, thereby destroying the best cache of deep-sea UFO evidence ever collected.
In the beginning, Ivan Sanderson was thinking about USOs as creatures that were in the air, that came into water. Towards the end of his career, he also had to engage in thinking about them as possibly intelligent craft from outer space.
Coming up, an eyewitness report of two massive disc-like objects emerging from an Australian lagoon and leaving evidence in its wake. According to experts, one of the most impressive traits of USOs is their ability to affect, change, and displace the surface of the water. in much the same way that UFOs in our skies reportedly generate similar crop circles on land.
An interesting aspect of UFO USOs is the fact that they leave a physical presence on the water.
USOs create the same kind of effect over water, over ice. So there's a real similarity between the physical trace evidence of a USO landing and a UFO landing on planet Earth.
It's like if you took a glass and stuck it in water, right? Well, now you have a hole in the water.
To USO researchers, the most impressive and well-publicized water crop circle case is the Tully Water Nest case, which occurred in northern Australia in January 1966.
This Tully's Nest story was one of the most publicized USO / UFO events in Australia. In fact, it had much the same kind of publicity that Roswell had here in the United States because everybody was involved, the military, the newspapers. It became a tourist attraction. People made pilgrimages to Tully's Nest to see where the USO came out of the water.
Over the past decade, Australian researcher Bill Chalker has conducted the most intensive study of the Tully case.
At 9 a.m. on January the 19th, 1966, young farmer George Pedley was driving a tractor through a neighbouring farmer's property, a place called Horseshoe Lagoon near Tully in far north Queensland. And he first started to experience some problems with his tractor. It seemed to be sort of missing and as if it was about to stop on him. And then he heard this high-pitched hissing noise, and he looked in the direction of where this noise was coming from, and at about 20 to 30 feet away, rising from the lagoon, was a sort of a dish-shaped, metallic-looking object that rose up to an altitude of about 30 to 40 feet. And then appeared to go into a shallow dive and then take off at high speed.
George Pedley described the object as appearing like two massive dinner plates stacked atop one another, about 30 feet in width and 12 feet in height.
It was a media sensation for quite a number of weeks, with sort of correspondents appearing, giving kind of on-the-spot reports, and there was even international coverage of it, and it was described in the press as a flying saucer nest.
This nest contained evidence of a reported USO touchdown, a distinctive imprint left behind on the surface of the lagoon.
The whirlpool effect in the water lasted for days and days after the USO took off. The Navy tested it, scientists tested it. A lot of tests were done on it and analyses were done on it, and there were all kinds of theories. And what they found was nothing could explain the water impressions.
In his numerous interviews and investigations over the years, Chalker found George Pedley to be a unique USO witness.
Yeah, George Pedley impressed me as being a very credible kind of witness, a typical kind of North Queenslander type cane farmer character, really the last kind of person you'd expect to come out with a story like this.
During the various public and private investigations in Tully over the subsequent weeks, at least a half dozen other water nests were identified in the area. Water samples were sent to the physics department at the University of Brisbane for radiation testing. A read from the center of the water nest tested positive for beta radiation. But within days, the sample mysteriously disappeared. Research into the Tully case continues to this day. With no shortage of USO cases in the past and present, many continue to wonder why these objects are here and what could possibly be next.
My belief is you got this big universe and all these different planets. I mean, anything is possible. Why should we be the only intelligent beings?
Some researchers interpret the recent events involving USOs as something more sinister.
I believe that there are extraterrestrial civilizations who have been watching our development over the last 100 years, with knowing there's a lot of promise, but also a lot of risk.
No doubt about it, there's something going on. They're covering stuff up, they're lying, and I would like to see congressional hearings in Washington to cut the crap and let's see what's going on, you know?
Does it mean that somehow there's an event coming on planet Earth, cataclysmic, end of time, and somehow the USOs are coming out of the Earth because the Earth itself is in trouble? Maybe we're nearing the end of days.
I don't think this has been used for centuries.
Out there is a whole lost world.
An all-new series that brings to life these lost worlds premieres next on the History.